नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स इदं पुरे चित्तमचारिचारिकं येनेच्छकं यत्तकामं यथासुखं तदज्जहं निग्रहयिष्यामि योनिसोऽहत्यपभिन्नं वीर्यं कुसग्गौ। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू फोकस on Vipassana meditation, as you have seen in our announcement that this is Samatha Vipassana retreat. Yesterday you heard Samanera Jayanta talking on Samatha meditation, tranquility meditation. Today I want to talk on the other part, that is Vipassana meditation. This is very popular words. I think most of you or all of you have heard the word and know to some extent what it is. What is Vipassana meditation? Vipassana is a Pali word. It has been translated into English as insight meditation. I think that is somewhat close to the Pali word. Vipassana, vi means a very special. Passana means seeing. Seeing in a very special way is Vipassana. When you hear the word very special way, you might wonder whether you have to go to a laboratory and use various kind of chemicals and run certain tests to see what this meditation is. That is a very special meditation, especially of seeing. Not in everyday life, when you walk, when you are in the kitchen and when you eat and so forth, you may not feel how to see this, how to practice this very special way. Friends, a special way is a way that we normally, ordinarily do not see things as they are. This is very heavily loaded terms. What do we mean by seeing things as they really are? What are the things? Don't we see things as they really are when we open our eyes? We see colors, shapes, sizes, movements, and so on. We can see them when we open our eyes. That is an ordinary way. Anybody can see, even animals can see things in that way. We see, Buddha wanted us to see in a very special way. This special way is we see not with eyes open. That is a very special way. When we see eyes open, we see in ordinary way. So we close our eyes. not always necessarily we should close our eyes. Most of the time, we close our eyes and see. What can you see when you close your eyes? That is the very special way. To see things as they really are. What are the things? Things are, we normally don't see these things. When we open our eyes, we see all outside. We hear things from outside. We smell outside things. We taste outside things. We touch most of the time outside things. And we think above all of outside things. Outside, not in space, but even in time. We remember all sort of things. Because we have collected for many, many years, some of us quarter century, half a century, close to a century, we collected things through our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body and mind. And when we close our eyes, most of the time we go back. We go back in time, we go back in space, we go back in our feelings, in our perceptions, people, places, situations, so forth and so on, that we have experienced all our life. That is not also a special way. Anybody can do that. Everybody perhaps does it. And the other, when we close our eyes, we see, is for procrastinating, thinking, planning of the future. And we are in between these two, going to the past or going to the future. Friends, past is no longer here. Future has not come yet. It is very simple, very simple. It's a simple, ordinary, common sense understanding. But still, we spend our time thinking of the past, thinking of procrastinating or planning for the future. That also is not a special way. A special way is we normally don't focus our mind on the present. Now the special way is focusing mind on the present. What is happening now? What is going on now? For this, we need attention. Attention also has quality. Poor attention or rich attention, or poor quality attention or high quality attention. Poor quality attention, also any ordinary person, even very ordinary animals, can pay poor or low quality attention. For instance, when a cat wants to catch a mouse, cat has to pay attention to the movement of the mouse. Right? Any predator should pay attention to the movement of the prey to catch. That is also a kind of attention. That is what is called poor attention or low quality attention. Buddha compared that attention, it's a very beautiful simile. Buddha gave the similes for people to at least remember at least the simile. When they remember the simile, they can relate to the point that he stressed. The simile is that when you throw a stick or rock or frisbee to a dog, What does the dog do? Dog runs after it, either bites or brings it back to you. When you throw the same stick or frisbee or rock to a lion, lion will not go after the rock or stick. Lion will go after you. Lion wants to find out where it came from. Because lion wants to know the root. Dog, you can never train dog to behave like a lion. No matter how long you sleep with the dog, keep the dog in your bed and do everything to a dog. As soon as you let the dog go free, where does he go? To a dirty place. Any dog goes to a dirty place. When you release a lion, he will never go to eat grass. He goes to eat live prey. Big animals, like an elephant. That is the nature of lion. So, when we pay a high quality attention, we, or our mind, behaves exactly like lion. Not going to eat animals. Lion goes to the root. Similarly, high quality attention is the attention going to the root, to find out the roots. That means when we come to the present moment, we experience various things in the present moment. As I said, we remember things from the past, we think of the future, then we immediately become mindful. When the mind goes to the past, immediately we become mindful. When the mind goes to the future, we immediately become mindful. When we do mindful, what do? We see the root of this mind, vacillating mind, going back and forth between past and the future. We root the root. What is the root? Either we have greed, hatred, or delusion. You think of anything that comes to you from your memory, is it not based on your desire, anger, jealousy, tension, some traumatic experience? Or if you think of the future, what do you think about? Something related to greed, hatred, or delusion. Suppose you plan for the future to make more money. What is the base of that? Is desire. You plan for the future to buy a huge house, big house. What is the root? You have a desire to have a bigger house. Bigger house indicate your desire to have a spacious place. When you think of the past, you remember most of the time very, very bitter experience. That bitter experience is based either on greed, hatred, or delusion. It is very seldom people remember beautiful experience. Very seldom. If you do remember, mindfully cultivate it. For instance, this is also very good mindfulness practice. For instance, you remember something you have done very good Suppose somebody is drowning. You jump to the water and rescue the person, save the person's life. When you remember that, you will be very delighted, very happy. Cultivate this mental state mindfully. That is, you let go of your greed or desire, attachment to yourself, and you even were ready to sacrifice your life to save that person. You don't know what sort of risk you will take, because the person who is drowning can grab you and go down with you. You have to take that risk. Suppose you are a firefighter. You go and rescue somebody in a big fire. You remember that. You risk your life. You are not going there just to sacrifice your life, but you go to save that person's life. And later on, when you think of it, you will see what a risk you have taken to rescue that life. So this kind of good memory, we have to repeat. We have to repeat, meaning that we were ready to let go. This is, in a very profound way, we can think this is a way of letting go. What do you let go? You let go of the attachment to your life. I remember in 1981, there was a plane crash in Washington. It was a very heavy winter day. Plane was, when it was taking off, it crashed to the 14th Street Bridge, and many people fell into the water. Helicopter came and they put a rope to a person. Then he saw another woman was struggling. She could not swim. So he gave that rope to her. Helicopter lifted her and rescued her, then came back and put the rope again. The second time also rope went to this man. So he gave it to another woman who was struggling to escape and rescued her. Third time when the helicopter came, this man was drowned. Now, this is how some people sacrifice their own lives to save others' lives. If you remember an incident like this, that man may not remember, he is already gone, but if you remember that incident, that is the kind of memory we have to sustain, maintain. So there are certain memories we have to maintain and certain memories we have to forget. And that is why mindful attention is very important. When we pay mindful attention, we can see how we do things with greed and when we suffer. And we suffer. Anytime we do something with greed, the consequence is our own personal suffering and also causing suffering to others. This is invariable truth. If we do something with hatred, inevitable result is our own pain and suffering. If you do something with greed, with delusion, inevitable result is our own confusion and suffering. So we mindfully, when mind wanders here and there, immediately become mindful and try to go to the root of your experience. What are the roots? There are only six roots. Greed, hatred and delusion are negative roots. Non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion are positive roots. When you try to focus your mind in the present moment, as you remember so many things, and try to sort out those things and see how certain things rooted in greed caused you suffering in the past. How greed, how certain things rooted in greed is causing suffering now. And also remember how hatred, or if you have done something with hatred, or said something with hatred, and thought of hateful thoughts in the past, even now in meditation, if you remember them, if you have certain experience, and look at the experience, and very honestly, sincerely, then you will see that experience, if it is very unpleasant, painful, the root is either greed, hatred or desire. If you remember something very pleasant, peaceful, and see the root of that pleasant, peaceful experience is, root is non-greed, letting go, what we call sometimes generosity. So, when the mind wanders here and there, be mindful very quickly and bring it to the present moment and look at your own mind. If the mind is wondering about other people, don't worry about it. Just forget it and return to the breath. Return to your mind and keep returning to your breath and focus your mind on the breath. And then you will see this wandering mind will stay wandering if you allow greed or hatred or delusion to arise. It keeps wandering in that area and your meditation will be very painful. You will never have a good, pleasant, meaningful, peaceful meditation session. If the mind goes to something that you have done very meaningful, peaceful, to make yourself happy, to others happy, and then this moment on your cushion, you experience very peaceful meditation. So you, in order to make your meditation peaceful, try to see the roots and cultivate wholesome roots and don't cultivate unwholesome roots. So this is a very special way of looking at things. Here things means our body, our feelings, our perceptions, our thoughts and consciousness. These are the things we see. Our body is in a state of flux, changing all the time, never remaining the same for two consecutive moments. It is changing, 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 changing all the time. When you see this change, you understand that you cannot keep your own current bodily appearance, bodily strength, exactly the same way. Since it is changing, anything can happen to this body. The most inevitably, we grow old. Since body is changing, we grow old. You cannot stop that. Buddha said, and explaining, giving example of suffering, he said somebody, all living beings who are subject to old age, decay, sickness, we all are subject to these things. We are subject to getting old, subject to sickness, subject to becoming weak and so forth. Being subject to old age, decay, if one were to think, may I never grow old. May I never grow old. People not only think that they should not grow old, but they do everything possible to keep themselves young. Because of our clinging, attachment, craving for the current appearance, current strength, youthfulness. Nobody likes to grow old. Nobody likes to lose youthfulness. Everybody wants to be very young-looking, strong, and they do all kind of things. I don't have to list them. The market is full of remedies to keep you, we all young. There are very skillful, well-trained specialists who can advertise. Advertising industry is very rich because of this attitude. And we keep struggling and spending money, time, energy and so forth and so on, thinking that what they have advertised is true, that we can remain young. Eventually one day we will see grey hair, wrinkled skins, weak body, poor hearing, poor eyesight, poor appetite, poor appearance. We see that happens. In spite of all these things that we use to keep ourselves young, we grow old. And this is very unpleasant. And this is what is called suffering. Not to get what one wants is suffering. What we want? We want to be youth. We want to be young. Have youthfulness. And that's what we don't get. Not to get what one wants is suffering. And we wish very hard to keep ourselves in current stage. And here is the friction, tension, between the thought of remaining young and what is really happening. This we must see exactly as it is. This is called very special way of seeing. Very special way of seeing. That means We are getting old, we are changing, you know, inside we are changing all the time. And after some years, this inner change will express on our skin, on our outer appearance. When we meditate, practicing mindfulness, friends, this change, this is not just mere theory, this is a reality, the truth we experience. We experience these changes. We experience these changes. Our feelings don't stay the same. Our feelings are changing. Our feelings are changing every fraction of a second, always they are changing. Our perception is changing. Our awareness is changing. Our consciousness is changing. Thoughts that arise in our mind are changing. So what we see when we pay mindful attention to see things in a special way, we see these things happening to us. Normally, these are not the things that we want to see. These are the things that we want to shun, close, forget, and turn our blind eye to these things. But they appear sooner or later. It appears sooner if we mishandle our experiences. That means we worry about it. We don't take care of ourselves. We think negatively. We get upset all the time. We get angry all the time. And we messed up our life, then this occurrence will take place very quickly. We begin to see the aging manifest very quickly. So, when we are mindful, knowing this, we know that we cannot stop it, we cannot go against it. This is the intrinsic nature, the truth that we are born with, and therefore, instead of trying to stop it, we accept it. We accept it. And we go along with it. And then, our awareness of impermanence becomes very clear and strong. Then handling our life would become very easy. Not only that is one benefit. And the other is, when we see these changes, impermanence, as I mentioned several times, everything in our life is permanently impermanent. Remember this phrase, this sentence. Everything in us, except everything else in the world, whole universe, but we are referring to ourselves. When we practice meditation, we are becoming mindful not only of the outside things, but we are mindful of what is happening to us. This is our material that we have, our body, feeling and so forth. These are the things we are Buddha called things. These are the things as we want to see as they are. In order to see us as we are, in other words, we have to pay attention. When we pay attention, we are changing all the time. When we change all the time, when clinging, attachment to our good health arises, we don't become obsessed with good health. We understand this good health is good, but it is subject to change. It is impermanent. So when desire, greed arises for anything, we understand this greed is impermanent. When hatred arises, when we pay attention to our own mind, we can see hatred is impermanent. Object that we hate is impermanent. Situation that caused our hatred is impermanent. Fear, jealousy, when they arise, we understand that they all are impermanent. The situation that created fear and jealousy are impermanent. So when we see impermanence exactly as it is, then very easily we can let go of those all negative things that arise. Even our clinging to positive things will not become obsessive. We understand this attachment to even positive thing is impermanent. So when we see impermanence, what happens? Our mind comes to balance state or equanimous state, or rather neutral state. We don't try to cling to any particular thing in our body, feeling, perception, thought and consciousness. We don't cling to any of them. We accept them as they change. Then our mind becomes equanimous. Without going to any extremes. And our greed will not obsess our mind, and greed also we will not nourish, because it is impermanent. Greedy object is impermanent, greedy mental state is impermanent, and therefore we let go of greed. Similarly, hatred, since it is impermanent, we let go of hatred. Delusion is impermanent, we try not to dwell in delusion and let it go, because it is impermanent. Then we, in that place, we cultivate insight into this reality. This builds up as a habit, builds up as a habit. And this habit keeps us in balance. So, come back to the present moment. When you pay attention to the present moment, what is you find in the present moment? You find your breath, you find your feelings, you find your perceptions, you find your consciousness, you find your attention. They all are changing. They all are changing. None of them stays the same. No feeling, no perception, and so forth. They all are changing. So we are experiencing changes all the time. Then nothing can stay to bother us in our mind, because we learn to let go when the things are changing. We cannot stop it. We cannot stop it. We have to accept the change. We accept impermanence, and then move on. So, our clinging to various things, habits, sometimes we have unwholesome habits, we cling to them. When we see these changes, these unwholesome habits are changing, impermanent, we let them go, we don't cultivate them. Sometimes, unmindfully, we nourish the unwholesome habit, thinking that what can I do, because that is my habit. Although it hurts me, it makes my life uncomfortable, miserable, I cannot change it because that is my habit. No, friends, no habit is permanent. We can change it. We can understand that the habit is also subject to change. When we see impermanence, nothing we can find permanent. So, for vipassana meditation, paying attention to impermanence is absolutely necessary. And for that we have to use our own body feeling and so forth. This is our laboratory. This is our laboratory. If we allow our mind to go into other laboratories, normally we don't look inside ourselves. We think of other people, how the people eat, how other people talk, how other people dress, what other people have, and we don't think of ourselves. So, we on the one hand, when we think of other people, we cultivate conceit, a pride, which makes us very, very uncomfortable, painful. For instance, the Pali word for conceit is mana. Mana is a measure. Measure that we use. Yardsticks or cups or measuring cup or the scale or whatever. These are the things that we use for measuring. The same word is used for mana, conceit, because we use ourselves as a measure. My appearance is such and such, so and so's appearance is such and such. My height is such and such, so and so's height is such and such. My bank account is such and such, so and so's account is such and such. My house is such and such, so and so's house is such and such. So, I use myself to measure others. So long as we do this unmindfully, without taking all the variable factors that makes our differences, I use myself to measure others. And therefore, when we do not pay attention to our own mind, use our own laboratory, we use others' laboratory, others' body, others' feelings, others' appearance, others' account, and so on. This way, unmindfully, we cultivate or develop and sustain our conceit in addition to greed. And also we unmindfully develop our wrong views, because so-and-so says such and such, is it right or wrong? So-and-so says such and such, is it right or wrong? This is my view, and so forth. We develop our views because of our wrong or what you call unmindful reflection, unmindful attention. So, the Buddha's advice is come back all the time into your mind, see whether these thoughts, these feelings, these speculations and theories and so forth, you built because of your pride, conceit, or your wrong view, or your greed. Because of the greed we can develop various type of views. Because of our hatred we can develop certain kind of views. We can, because of our ignorance we can develop certain kinds of views. So even for greed, hatred and delusion, even views, there are these three, this unmindful reflection can multiply them, cultivate them, increase them. And therefore, this is how we get carried away with all kind of thoughts, ideas and views. So Buddha gave very beautiful simile to illustrate this. It is the simile of quail and hawk. Quail and hawk. Quail is a very tiny little bird. One day this quail was sitting on a plot of mud. A hawk came. Hawk is a big bird. He came and grabbed the quail. Then quail began to cry. And he said, "What to do? Today is my unlucky day. Had I been in my own ancestral domain, this hawk is not match in a fight. I can defeat him very easily." The hawk thought, "This little fellow being in my mouth is boasting." So he asked, "Where is your ancestral home?" He said, he showed the newly plowed rice field with big clod of mud. He said, "That is my domain." "Okay, I release you, I take you there, I leave you there. But remember, tomorrow I will come and get you." Hawk flew away. And next day, this quail came and sat on the clod of mud, basking in the sun, enjoying. Then hawk came. And he saw hawk coming. Then immediately he went under the clod of mud. The hawk saw the quail from distance. When he approached, he couldn't find the quail. The hawk was so upset, he beat his breast and flew away. So the Buddha said, if we stay in our own domain, if the meditator stays in his or her own domain, Mara will not get him. Mara will not catch him. What is this Mara? Mara is all our defilements. Figuratively speaking, all defilements put together and called Mara. Because when the mind starts wandering, mind start thinking of other people, thinking of the universe, the world, politics, countries, and so forth, governments and so forth and so on, keep, so that mind is cluttered with defilements. Therefore, Buddha said, come back to your own domain. Come back to your own domain. What is your domain? Your body, your feeling, your perceptions, thoughts and consciousness. These are the things that we have to work with. And these are the things that we see exactly as they are. We see the body as it is. We see the feelings as they are. We see the perception as it is. We see thoughts as they are. We see consciousness as it is. As it is means the body is changing all the time. Feelings are changing all the time. Perception changing. Thoughts are changing. Consciousness changing. In this changing form, feeling and so forth, there is nothing permanently, eternally lodged. Nothing permanently, eternally established. They all are changing. When we see this change, it is very easy to go along with the changing of the body, changing of feelings, perception, thought and consciousness. We remain calm, relaxed, peaceful. Friends, this is a wonderful way of reducing your stress, removing your stress by accepting what we are, accepting we, expecting us as we are, accepting our body as it is, feeling and so forth as they are. This is what is called seeing things as they really are. Seeing things means these aggregates, body, feeling and so forth, which are made up of elements. Elements are changing. And the object that is made up of those elements also are changing. They all are impermanent. And they trying to attach, becoming attached to anything impermanent is unsatisfactory, building tension, anxiety, worry. When you try to stop impermanence, where you end up with? Anxiety. Stress. When we don't try to stop changes and go along with it, no stress, no tension, no friction. This is a very, very profound way of looking at our own, or profound way of practicing vipassana meditation. And therefore, in other words, in vipassana meditation, what we do, we see impermanence, and trying to become attached to impermanence, we build up anxiety, tension, that's called suffering. And this is because of our ignorance. We don't know how to handle our life. We are ignorant, and we build up our confusion, delusion, and seeing these three very clearly and getting rid of our attachment to impermanent things, we can reduce our tension, anxiety, and we develop our insight, wisdom. When we do this, when we see impermanence exactly as they are, we become calm, relaxed, peaceful, and gain concentration. With this concentration, we can look back again into our body, feeling, perceptions and so forth, to go into the very deep understanding of their continuous change, impermanence, not having any permanent entity called self. Then we will not develop greed, hatred and delusion with regard to anything. And this is the summary, in short, of vipassana meditation. Vipassana meditation is a big subject. I think you have read the book that I have written on vipassana meditation called Mindfulness in Plain English, where chapter 13 particularly, I have tried to explain it in a very lucid, simple, understandable English. So it is difficult to bring all of them together in one little talk like this. And I hope you will continue your practice, then you will... It is your practice, friends. Nothing else, no matter how much talk to you listen to, how many books you read, how many retreats you attend to, nothing else can bring you this insight but the practice. You are your laboratory, you are your domain, and you keep practicing until you reach your perfection. Practice makes perfect. Nothing else we can do about it but practice. I wish you success.